हेलो हेलो। सर स्टार्ट कर दो 10 बजे। यूवी स्पेक्ट्रम वी यूज इज यूवीबी एंड यूवीए, एज यूवीसी इज एब्जॉर्ब एट द स्ट्रेटोस्फीयर। सो कमिंग टू हिस्टोरिकल, अर्लियर इन द अराउंड 2000 BC, एमीमेजस, दिस वॉज द प्लांट विच वॉज यूज फॉर द ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ ल्यूकोडर्मा बाय द इजिप्टिशियन एंड ऑल्सो इन इंडिया द सोरेलिया कॉर्लीफोलिया, दिस वॉज ऑल्सो नोन एज बापजी, वॉज ऑल्सो यूज एज अ ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ ल्यूकोडर्मा इन एंशियंट पीरियड। कमिंग टू द मॉडर्न थेरेपी, वेर द फर्स्ट डर्मेटोलॉजिस्ट दैट नील फिंसन, ही वॉज अवॉर्डेड एज द नोबल प्राइज फॉर द ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ ल्यूपस वल्गैरिस। सो दिस वॉज द पिक्चर एट दैट टाइम एट द अराउंड 1860s, वेर ही वॉज यूजिंग वेर ही मेड ए लैम्प विच वॉज मेनली यूज टू ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ ल्यूपस वल्गैरिस। सो करेंट मॉडलिटी ऑफ थेरेपी विच वी इंक्लूड एज अ लाइट बेस्ड थेरेपी आर फोटोकीमोथेरेपी, नैरो बैंड यूवीबी, यूवीए, एक्जाइमर लेजर, एक्स्ट्राकॉर्पियल फोटोकीमोथेरेपी, फोटोडायनेमिक थेरेपी एंड ब्लेनियो फोटोथेरेपी। सो कमिंग टू पूवा थेरेपी, सो पूवा थेरेपी मेनली कंसिस्ट ऑफ ए फोटोसिंथेटिक एजेंट दैट इज सोरालिन एंड प्लस यूवीए थेरेपी विच कंसिस्ट ऑफ वेवलेंथ ऑफ 320 to 400 नैनोमीटर। दिस सोरालिन कैन बी ऑब्टेन फ्रॉम वेरियस प्लांट सोर्सेस। इन इंडिया द मोस्ट कॉमन सोर्स ऑफ प्लांट इज बापजी एंड इन इजिप्ट इट वॉज एमीमेजस। अदर सोर्सेस वेर वी कैन ऑब्टेन सोरालिन इज फ्रॉम लाइम और सेरेली प्लांट्स और बेरगामोट। सो कमिंग टू देर आर वेरियस टाइप्स ऑफ सोरालिन, आउट ऑफ विच थ्री आर इम्पॉर्टेंट टू अस बिकॉज वी यूजली यूज मोस्टली इन आवर थेरेपी पर्पज। वन इज 8-MOP, 5-MOP एंड TMP। सो द सोर्स ऑफ 8-MOP इज फ्रॉम एमीमेजस एंड फॉर 5-MOP इट वॉज बर्गामट ऑयल। दिस इज ऑल्सो नोन एज फॉर दिस इट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज बर्गाप्टिन एंड TMP विच वॉज ऑब्टेन फ्रॉम बापची। सो द 8-OMP द बायोअवेलेबिलिटी इज अराउंड 75 to 80%, वेर 5-MOP इज अराउंड 98 to 99%, वेर TMP इज हैज पुअर बायोअवेलेबिलिटी बोथ टॉपिकली एज वेल एज ओरल। कमिंग टू फोटोटॉक्सिसिटी प्रोड्यूस्ड, 8-MOP ओरल फॉर्म इज मोर टॉक्सिक एज कम्पेयर टू द TMP फॉर्म एंड इन टॉपिकल TMP इज मोर फोटोटॉक्सिक एज कम्पेयर टू द 5-MOP एंड 8-MOP। द TMP इज ऑल्सो कॉजिंग लिम्फोटॉक्सिक इफेक्ट ऑल्सो। एफिकेसी वाइज कंपेयरिंग TMP इज मोर एफिकेसियस एज कम्पेयर टू 8-MOP, बट ड्यू टू इट्स पुअर बायबिलिटी ओरली मोस्टली इट इज यूज एज ए टॉपिकल फॉर्म। इट इज सो इट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज बाथ पुवा। कमिंग टू द डिफरेंट ब्रांड्स एंड कॉस्ट ऑफ द ओरल सोरालिन, सो दिस आर द वाट आर द ब्रांड्स दैट आर अवेलेबल इन इंडिया। 5-MOP इज नॉट अवेलेबल इन आवर कंट्री। दिस ऑल्सो 8-MOP इज ऑल्सो अवेलेबल एज ए सॉल्यूशन फॉर्म, एज अ ऑइंटमेंट फॉर्म ऑल्सो, एंड दिस आर द टेबलेट फॉर्म ऑफ 8-OMP एंड दिस इज ट्राइमॉफ विच इज ऑल्सो नोन एज विच इज ऑल्सो नोन एज TMP एंड दैट इज अवेलेबल एज 5 mg एंड 25 mg। कमिंग टू द मैकेनिज्म ऑफ पुवा, there are basically 5 mechanisms of action of PUVA. One mechanism is cross linking with DNA. This lead to the upregulation of p53 that leads to the cell arrest and also cell division suppression also. This leads to cell death, also lead to mutation and carcinogenesis. There is also formation of reactive oxygen species. This oxygen species, they bind to the phospholipid of the membrane, and it leads to lipid peroxidation, as well as also leads to different signaling pathway, and also lead to indirect DNA damage. Another mechanism is apoptosis. This is mainly this mechanism is mainly due to the mitochondrial dysfunction. The sorrelin that produces a apoptogenic photo product that leads to mitochondrial dysfunction. The most of the apoptosis is mainly the lymphocytes as compared to the keratinocytes. Coming to immunomodulatory effect, it helps in down regulation of EGF, as well as also cytokines and chemokines. Also, it down regulates the pro-inflammatory axis, that is TH1 and TH2, and also keeps a balance between the TH1 and TH2 pathway. It also down regulates antigen presenting cells, mostly the Langerhans cells, and also induces the T regulatory cells production and inhibition of angiogenesis. Coming to melanogenesis, it mainly upregulates the tyrosinase pathway and also proliferation of melanocytes and also melanin transfer to the keratinocytes. It also stimulates the hair follicle melanocytes also. So the oral dose regime is we mostly in our country 8 MOP we give at around 6.6 milligram per kg. After that, near about 2 hours we expose to UVVA, and also we advise for eye protection. The eye protection has to be around 8 to 12 hours after ingestion of sorrelin. So this is the weight-wise dose of 8 MOP. Here we have to keep in mind that the maximum dose should not go more than 50 milligram. This is the UVA radiation based on the skin phototype. Most of our country has type 4 and type 5. So we start from the starting dose is around 2 joules in our country. So based on this earlier consensus, where two guidelines were there, regimes were there. One was European based regime and one was American based regime. The European based regime was mainly based on a minimum phototoxic dose, whereas the American was based on fixed dose. And also fixed increment. The efficacy or clearance wise both were comparable, but in European guideline the mean time of clearance was lesser as compared to the American guideline. And also the cumulative dose of the UVA, the minimum if we give according to the minimum phototoxic dose, it was very minimal as compared to the American skin type based regimen, where the cumulative dose of UVA was more. So overall, we can say that European guideline was better as compared to the American guideline. But since in Indian scenario, the minimum phototoxic dose is difficult to calculate. Coming to the AIMS protocol, initially we give 8 MOP of 0.6 milligram, and after 2 hours we give UVA exposure. The starting dose is 2 joules, and we increase up to 20% per session, and it was given thrice weekly. For psoriasis patient, we review after 50 treatments, and for vitiligo after 30 treatments. And if there is repigmentation or there is improvement is present, then we continue till 1 year. Or if there is no improvement, then we can switch to other modality of therapy. For mycosis fungoides, three times a week, and for other dermatitis reaction, we give 3 times for 8 weeks. Then next 8 weeks, 2 times, and then next for 8 weeks once weekly, and then we stop. Based upon the phototoxic reaction also, the dose schedule has to be adjusted accordingly. If there is no erythema, then we have to follow simply 20% increment. And if there is erythema present, but it lasts, it resolves on its own, then 20% increment. If previous dose also there was erythema present, then we have to hold the dose or increase up to 10%. Similarly, if there is asymptomatic erythema, then repeat the previous dose with 10% increment. And if there is asymptomatic erythema, then we have to postpone the dose and again repeat the previous dose with 10% increment. Finally, in E3, we have to stop the drug and we have to again start with the 50% of the previous dose and then 10% increment. And in E4, we have to stop the treatment and review. This is based on the response of pruritus and the response based on the therapy. This is based on the mixed treatment. We also adjust the dose. This was the AIMS protocol. of one patient mainly who was coming for the large plaque parapsoriasis, and it was started at 2 joules, and subsequently these slides already I have mentioned previously. There are other modalities of delivering POVA therapy. One was oral therapy, which I have discussed earlier. Now, other modalities of topical POVA therapy can be by through paint POVA, or bath POVA, or soak POVA, or turban POVA, or bathing suit POVA. Coming to paint POVA, this is applied. This is basically the it comes as a 8 AMP comes as an ointment of 7.5% or a solution of 1%. In our aims, we use 1% solution, which we dilute into 1:40, and the concentration of 0.25%, which is used for vitiligo treatment, and higher concentration that can be up to 0.1% can be used for plaque psoriasis. So here mainly the advantage of this paint POVA is that the GI toxicity that we occur due to the oral dose of POVA, that oral dose of soralin, that can be reduced. The eye protection is not required, there is no drug interaction, and also it is safe in hepatic and renal disease. The main disadvantage is that the non-uniform distribution, as well as it does not prevent the new lesions formation, and also it is laborious if there is extensive or more lesions. So this is the melanosil 1% solution, and we dilute in propylene glycol 1:40 ratio. Then coming to bath POVA, we usually use 8 AMP, and of concentration of 3.75 milligram is used. We can use as low as 2.6 milligram per liter, also concentration. Here we soak the body for 20 minutes, 10 minutes in supine position and 10 minutes in prone position, then wipe off the excess soralin, and then immediately expose to the UV therapy. This is the bathtub, which has a marking, and this has to be taken thrice weekly, and this is the UVA chamber. Coming to advantages of bath POVA, here we can see that the total cumulative dose of UVA is 3 to 6 times lower as compared to the oral POVA. It can be also given to the generalized body, and also the skin soralin, the concentration is high, that is as comparable with the oral POVA. The soralin readily absorbed by the skin and promptly get eliminated. The plasma level is low, so there is minimum toxicity. The main disadvantage is that it is time taking, it is expensive, also the lot of water wastage is also there, and also close supervision is required for this. The main indication for bath POVA, though there are various indications, the main indication is mainly which has good recommendation, strength of recommendation, that was psoriasis. Coming to soak POVA, this is basically used for the localized lesion, mostly on the hands or feet. The visually soak the hand and feet in 3.75 milligram per liter of 8 AMP, and usually we soak for around 20-30 minutes, and after that we expose to UVA, and the frequency is 3 to 4 times. And if the lesions are present on the dorsum of the dorsum, so we have to give 50% of the dose. So this is the hand and foot UVA unit, where you have to expose the palm and sole. So basically, mostly it is used for the localized, that is palmoplantar psoriasis or chronic palmoplantar psoriasis. Then coming to turban POVA, this was basically used as a treatment of alopecia areata, where we dilute in 10.5 ml of 1% solution in 2 liter of water. The cloth is soaked for around 30 seconds, and then it is wrapped in a turban fashion over the head for 5 minutes, and again it is soaked in the this solution, and again it is wrapped over the head for 5 minutes. This process is repeated up to 20 minutes. After that, we expose UVA for 5 to 15 minutes, and this is done thrice a week. This is the turban worn by the patient over the head. Mainly it is used for alopecia areata and chronic GVHD, but the recommendation is only case series and case report has been documented. Coming to turbo POVA, why we call it as a turbo? Because here we use a higher dose of UVA. Mainly the mechanism of this is we use dihydroacetone, which is a part of a sunscreen, and this comes as a 15% cream, which you have to apply all over the body except for the cover side. And after the application, this binds to the stratum corneum and it forms a melanidine, which has an action similar to the melanin. So in psoriatic skin lesions where the proliferation of the keratinocyte is higher, that is 3 to 4 days, so we expose the PUVA therapy after 72 hours. So this the normal skin which is protected by DHA and the psoriatic skins where we can give higher dose of UVA. So that's why it is known as turbo PUVA. The main advantage is that the less amount of drug is given and it can be safely carried out at home. There is no systemic side effect and also less time consuming. The major disadvantage is that entire body surface area has to be applied and the concentration of sorolene may not be uniform. Coming to the, since as we know that the patient has to expose is all of the whole body while in UVA exposure at home. So cloth, there was also a trial where cloth on PUVA can be, was compared with the normal exposed. So there were two groups, one was PUVA without wearing the clothes and one was with wearing the clothes. Here a cotton fabric was used and based upon the SPF value of the cotton fabric, the dose of UVA was given. So in both the groups with and without cloths, it was found to be effective and there was no difference in the side effect also. Now coming that, as we know that UVA chamber therapy can be mostly available at the tertiary center, so it also leads to less compliance of the therapy. So where the facility of UVA chamber is not available, so we can also use sunlight as a source of UVA. So this is known as PUVASOL. We can use both oral as well as topical form of sorolene. In psoriasis, we increase 5 minutes per exposure and we can increase up to 30 minutes, and for vitiligo we increase by every 2 minutes every third session. The ideal time for exposure is only 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. or 2:30 to 3:30. Mostly we recommend this time because the ultraviolet B radiation and infrared radiation is a minimum at this time. This was a trial where cost effectiveness of PUVA versus PUVASOL was done in our department, where it was found that both PUVA and PUVASOL was cost effective and equally efficacious, PUVA and PUVASOL was both equally efficacious in treatment of psoriasis, but PUVASOL was twice as cost effective. This was another trial done in our department where comparison of PUVASOL and PUVA was done, where in vitiligo, where PUVA showed mean percentage of repigmentation was 46% and PUVASOL was 26%. So oral PUVA was more efficacious than PUVA therapy was more efficacious than PUVASOL, but based upon the phototoxicity and compliance as well as feasibility, PUVASOL can be recommended. This was a comparison where PUVASOL and narrowband UV therapy was done. This study mainly depicts that the narrowband therapy was found more effective and most cosmetically repigmentation and color matching was done as compared to the PUVASOL. The another disadvantages of PUVASOL is that since we know that there is no uniform irradiance exposure of UVBA throughout the season, so this was a study done in PGH Chandigarh where they found during the summer season, April to July, the mean exposure to get 2 joule was around 12 minutes and also in November to February it was 30 minutes. So major advantages of PUVASOL is that it is cheap, convenient, and there is no frequent hospital visit also required. And also in tropical countries where there is ambient sunlight, so it can be a good modality of therapy. Where the major drawback is that seasonal variety of the UVB exposure, so correct dose can the finding a correct dose is very difficult. Also there is high incidence of symptomatic erythema and phototoxicity with this and need private space. There are other types like blue point, there is point source of UVB therapy, UVA therapy, which can be used for localized lesion like oral and also nail psoriasis. And also there is PUVA COM, which can be easily used for unaccessible site like scalp. So main indications for PUVA therapies, FDA approval is psoriasis, vitiligo and CTCL. There are other off-label use like photodermatosis, where like PMLE or CAD or porphyrial ecclesions or solar urticaria. Pruritic disorders we can also give. Papulosquamous lesions like parapsoriasis, which we commonly encounter in our OPD scenario, and we give POVA therapy. And also autoimmune disease like amorphia or LSA. So what precautions do we take with POVA therapy? So before exposure, the drug has to be taken with meal or food. There should be application of moisturizer or aqueous cream. There should not be any application of any alcohol or bath soap or deodorant. While in POVA unit, the eyes should be protected with UVA opaque goggles that can be B2 torrid and green glasses, which have been discussed in the sunscreen seminar. And also face should be covered with sunscreen, and the male genitals that should be covered. After UV exposure, the patient has to wear UV glass and also full clothes and sunscreen and avoid sunlight throughout the day. During the non-treatment days, the patient has to apply sunscreen and avoid sunlight. So this was the guideline from Oxford Churchill, where they advised UVA 400 level glass. And also if the patient is wearing spectacles, so he can wear underneath this UV sun shield. Coming to the monitoring guidelines, particularly this is mostly recommended for the fairer skins, but in country like India, at least a baseline evaluation that should be done. If any suspicion lesion or any previous therapy of POVA, skin examination should be done at the baseline. And also eye complaints, if the patient has any visual complaints, then it should be examined through gross examination, slitsmen and fundoscopy. And also since soraline has found to have less hepatotoxicity, but it can occur, so prior to the baseline, CBC, LFT and RFT should be done. And if it is normal, then it is not further required. Coming to a recommendation for psoriasis, comparing oral POVA with topical POVA therapy, it is found that the oral POVA is not overall, it was not more effective than topical POVA. So topical POVA can be given if there is more toxicity to the oral POVA. Coming to combination POVA versus oral systemic therapy, POVA therapy should be usually offered before oral systemic therapy like methotrexate or any other azoram, or this before that POVA therapy should be recommended. Comparison with POVA and biologics, there are very less study considering comparison with POVA and biological therapy, but POVA therapy should be considered before biological therapy. POVA versus narrowband UV therapy, both are equally efficacious in psoriasis treatment, but due to the side effect of POVA, narrowband UV therapy has to be considered prior to the POVA therapy. In vitiligo, comparing with POVA with narrowband UV therapy, basically, POVA is considered when there is no response or there is no availability of narrowband UV therapy. So, narrowband UV therapy is a choice of phototherapy as compared to the POVA therapy. Coming for the CTCL recommendation, mainly POVA therapy is the first line therapy for plaque stage of MF. We can also combine with retinoids. It decreases the number of session and dose of POVA session. With coming with POVA and total skin electron beam therapy, we know that the total external beam therapy is usually not appropriate for early disease. And also when we combine POVA therapy with total external beam therapy, there was no survival difference that was obtained. Coming to POVA versus narrowband UV therapy comparison, as far as the British Association Dermatology guideline, the PAS test or hypopigmented stage of CTCL, the narrow band is as effective as POVA therapy in treatment of choice. And for plaque stages, POVA therapy is the treatment of choice. Coming for photodermatosis, where for PMLE, POVA should be, though the recommendation is strength is poor, but POVA therapy should be considered before systemic therapy. and narrow band therapy should and if there is availability of narrow band therapy, then we should consider before PUVA therapy. For chronic actinic dermatitis or idiopathic urticaria, only few studies are available. So this should be the PUVA therapy should be given under specialist unit only. Coming to combination, initially PUVA and methotrexate combination, they were found to have synergistic action, and it was also thought that it was more carcinogenic. Association was there with methotrexate, but we can give methotrexate 3 weeks prior to PUVA, then combine PUVA with methotrexate, and if the lesions are cleared, then we can stop methotrexate and maintain on PUVA therapy. Coming with acetretinoin with PUVA, this is also known as re-PUVA. We have to start 2 weeks prior acetretinoin so that the plaque lesions become the plaque, the thickness of the plaque get reduced, and after that we can continue PUVA and acetretinoin and stop acetretinoin and maintain on PUVA therapy. Coming to the topical therapy, PUVA versus calcipo trial. This calcipo trial should be applied 2 hours prior to the PUVA therapy or 2 hours later, because PUVA therapy inactivates calcipo trial. Tesseratin, it is synergistically, both are synergistic, so can be applied together, and emollient usually improves the UVA transmission, so this can be also applied. Regarding PUVA therapy with topical steroid, most of the studies have shown no much benefit, and some studies also have shown benefit. Cyclosporin is usually not advisable because it increases the risk of malignancy. This is coming to re-PUVA, which we combine PUVA therapy with acetretinoin. If acetretinoin, if there is a issue with the contraception, then isotretinoin can be also given. The both act synergistically. It accelerates the desquamation of psoriatic plaque, and also it reduces photoaging, and also it lead to less cumulative dose of PUVA and long-term remission. So this is a case where of severe chronic plaque psoriasis, where after 2 months of acetretinoin therapy, there was significant improvement. Coming to maintenance dose therapy, there are no consensus regarding the maintenance of the therapy. Usually it is advisable that we should avoid maintenance therapy of UVA exposure, but in case of rapid relapsing like CTCL or as a rotational therapy, we can use as a maintenance. Mainly disadvantage of maintenance therapy is that it consumes time and also money, and also interferes with the patient quality and further exposure of the UVA. Contraindications, the absolute contraindications, mostly the photosensitive diseases like xeroderma pigmentosa, SLE or dermatomyositis, this is absolute contraindication. Whereas there are various relative contraindication, mainly pregnancy and also children less than 10 years. The side effects, coming to the side effects, acute side effects like phototoxic reaction, which is mostly encountered in PUVA therapy. Out of them, pruritus, itching, cognization, and blister lesions can be formed. These all lesions can be maintained symptomatically. If there is a patient complaining of itching and not responding to antihistaminics, we have to diagnose as PUVA itch. This usually respond after stopping PUVA therapy. Coming to side effects due to oral PUVA, there can be mostly GI disturbance, CNS disturbance, bronchoconstriction, hepatotoxicity, and also drug-induced fever exanthem. Other side effects like herpes simplex recurrence and also photosensitive eruption can be seen. Various cutaneous manifestations also seen during the PUVA therapy like hypertrichosis, ankle edema, lentiginosis, poikiloderma, and elastosis, and acneiform eruption. Coming to long-term side effect, this is mostly encountered in the fairer skin. One is photoaging and ocular, mainly the sorolin get deposited in the lens, and also it causes cataract, and also it causes retinal damage. Skin cancer manifestation, mostly squamous cell is most common in, as compared to the basal cell carcinoma. The mainly depends on the cumulative dose. If the session is more than 200 or energy is more than 2000 joule per centimeter square, this increases the 14 times fold increase to the cancer. If the patient has multiple lentiginosis, this is also a high risk for the cancer. Also, it can cause melanoma, but it is rare in Indian skin. This is a phototoxic erythema induced by the PUVA therapy. This is the photoonycholysis. दिस इज द मल्टीपल लेंटिजिनोसिस आफ्टर पूवा थेरेपी. सो कमिंग टू द ड्यू टू द वेरियस साइड इफेक्ट्स एंड ऑल्सो द टॉक्सिस फोटोटॉक्सिसिटी द नैरो इवोल्यूशन वॉज दैट नैरो यूवीबी थेरेपी वॉज इंट्रोड्यूस्ड. This was mainly first introduced in 1977 for the plaque-like lesions where broadband was used, but it lacked efficacy, so the broadband UVB therapy was disrupted. It was mainly found that the particular wavelength of around 311 to 313 that was mostly effective for the psoriatic lesions. So in 1997, the first time the narrowband UVB therapy was used for the vitiligo patient. So the mechanism of action of UVB therapy, that mainly it decreases keratinocyte proliferation. Mainly UVB binds to the DNA and uricanic acid, that decreases protein and nucleic acid synthesis and also decrease keratinocyte proliferation. Coming to immunomodulatory effect, is also down regulates or it gives the balance between T helper type 1 and T helper type 2. Mainly the T helper type 2 is activated. And also it decreases the peripheral NK cells activity and also reverses the distribution of blood flow, blood vessels architecture. It also helps in synthesis of melanin, where it stabilizes the depigmentation process and also stimulate follicular melanocyte synthesis. And also it helps in a melanin migration to the depigmented cells. So comparing, it has found that the narrowband UV therapy also also helps in synthesis of vitamin D, which also helps in forming a mature melanocyte in the hair follicular bulbs, that helps in stimulation of melanin production and also differentiation. Coming to difference between narrowband and broadband therapy, the narrowband therapy has a faster action, fewer treatments and shorter duration of therapy and long-term remission. And since the narrowband the range from 311 to 313, this was mostly effective in treatments. So currently narrowband UVB therapy is more preferred as compared to the broadband UVB therapy. So indications is similar to as PUVA therapy, that is psoriasis, vitiligo and CTCL, that has been FDA approved. Other therapies that can be included is androgenous dermatitis, or it can be also used in photodermatosis, also sclerosing disorders, lichen planus and granuloma annulare. So this is our AIMS protocol, where initial starting dose is 350 millijoules per centimeter square, and maximum dose is 4 joules per centimeter square. At each session, we give 20% increment and thrice weekly. This is same as compared to the PUVA therapy, and the side effects on is also same as compared to the PUVA therapy, which I mentioned earlier. And response and pruritus, as well as missed dose calculation, is also same as compared to the PUVA therapy. So coming to the vitiligo guideline consensus, this was given by vitiligo working group in 2017, where they have compared three times versus two times. They said that both are equally efficacious, but three times has earlier onset of repigmentation as compared to the twice weekly. The dose they have kept as fixed dose 20% and increment of 10 to 20% per session. And face maximum dose we can give is 1500 and body is 3000. The number of exposure on basically on Indian skin, there is no scaling effect, but in our protocol we give up maximum up to 1 year. So for narrowband UV therapy to see whether it is effective or not, we usually assess after 18 to 36 sessions. In our protocol, it is 30 sessions, and we see whether there is improvement or not. If there is improvement, then we continue the therapy. And if there is no improvement, if it is more than 48 sessions, if there is no improvement, then we can discontinue the therapy. So dose adjustment is also based on erythema, whether it is symptomatic or asymptomatic or no erythema. And also dose adjustment, they have also mentioned as far as the missed doses. They have also said regarding the dose adjustment when the device is calibrated, and also we have to evaluate the patient from the baseline during the follow-up every 3 monthly. Regarding post-exposure, they have applied sunscreen, broad spectrum sunscreen regardless of the skin type, and that should be have SPF more than 30, and it should be reapply every 2 hourly and avoids sun exposure. They have also advised that mineral oil like can be used topically before phototherapy in dry skin such as elbow or knee. Regarding the maintenance therapy, if the narrowband maintenance regime of narrowband UV therapy after the plateau response has reached, the first month we continue narrowband twice weekly, and in second month we continue for 1 weekly, and third month we continue phototherapy once every alternate weekly, and 4 months and beyond after the plateau treatment has response, discontinue the phototherapy. Then coming to the follow-up, all patients should be returned for the treatment in case of relapse, and annual full body skin examination should be done for this patient to in skin phototype 1 to 3, and it is not needed for skin for Indian skin. Coming to the combination therapy, it was found that combination therapy with narrowband therapy was found to be superior except for the calcipore trial. And two studies were showing narrowband versus antioxidant. There was comparison with narrowband UV therapy. There was increase adding antioxidant. It shows increase relative risk increase efficacy of around 1.7 as compared to the narrowband UV. Adding tacrolimus also has increased superiority of improvement. While combining narrowband UV therapy with different modalities of therapy like argem laser, 5-fluorouracil or 5-fluoro injection, there is less study. The study was heterogeneous in this randomized controlled trial, so it was not able to comment. So overall, a recommendation for vitiligo, narrowband UV therapy as a monotherapy, the evidence level is low. For Indian skin, it is highly it can be considered as a first line therapy. Coming to a narrowband UV therapy plus calcipore trial, though the evidence is lacking, though the current evidence does not suggest any benefit to a calcipore trial with narrowband UV therapy. With tacrolimus, it has shown additive benefit. With folic acid, vitamin E, and also sorolene, this has not found to be superiorly or significantly more effective as compared to narrowband therapy alone. Comparing narrowband UV therapy with OMP versus PUVA therapy or broadband UV therapy, the combination of narrowband UV therapy with OMP has found has marked to moderate response over following period of 3 months of therapy. With antioxidant, also it has found that 47% of the patient has achieved 75% repigmentation as compared to the 18% in narrowband UV therapy alone. Narrowband UV therapy with adjuvant surgery therapy, autologous cellular suspense transmission surgery also leads to clinical improvement after combining with narrowband UV therapy. With narrowband UV therapy and laser plus laser and derma abrasion, this has also has a good clinical outcome. With excimer laser, comparison with excimer laser, most of the study have shown that excimer laser is more effective as compared to the narrowband UV therapy. But targeted narrowband UV therapy and broadband UVB therapy has shown equal effect as compared to the excimer laser. Narrowband UV therapy with other phototherapy, narrowband UV therapy is a treatment of choice because it has least side effect as compared to the systemic PUVA. Coming for the psoriasis, we have to determine MED. And based on the skin type in our Indian scenario, 500 millijoules per centimeter square is the starting dose. Based upon the subsequent visit, the erythema, if the erythema lasting less than 24 hours, you have to increase by 20%. If the erythema persists for more than 24 hours and less than 48 hours, then continue the previous dose till the erythema resolves. And if it is more than 48 hours, then no treatment required and return to the dose of the last lower dose that did not cause any erythema. Based on the mixed session also, the dose has been also given. Coming to maintenance therapy, once the patient psoriasis has cleared, The maintenance dose should be the last dose that is given prior to the clearing of the lesions. This has to be continued twice weekly for four weeks, once weekly for 4 weeks, and then the dose should be held. If there is a for prolonged maintenance therapy, if the patient should receive a treatment every 1 to 2 weeks, and final dose should decrease by 25% and held constant for maintenance treatment. The maximum dose of narrowband UV therapy for Indian skin type is 4 and 3 is around 3000 millijoules per centimeter square. Coming to recommendation, this is a joint American Academy of Dermatology guideline. The narrowband UVB therapy is recommended in chronic plaque psoriasis with good strength of recommendation. It is also given thrice weekly, and short-term PUVA therapy is found more efficacious than narrowband UVB therapy, but comparing the side effect and inconvenience, this should be considered. A narrowband UV therapy should be considered. Narrowband UV therapy is also recommended over broadband UV therapy. And if there is no availability of whole chamber therapy, so home-based targeted therapy can be given at the at the home. It can be also given safely in pregnancy, but though it is strength of recommendation is C, but it can be given. Comparing long-term cyclosporine with narrowband therapy there is increased incidence of skin cancer, so it is usually not recommended. And also combining with apremilast with narrowband UV therapy, it can be considered in adult patient only, and with generalized plaque psoriasis which does not respond to monotherapy. And also women bearing child age before receiving narrowband UV therapy should receive folate supplement. So narrowband UV PUVA therapy has shown equally effective, and also combining with Coltar and emollient, it has also improved the clearance. With vitamin D alone, studies are inconclusive, but it can be considered and it should be applied 2 hours prior. With methotrexate, combination is more effective, and the dose of cumulative dose of narrowband UV therapy can also be reduced. With retinoids and cyclosporine, also the cumulative dose of narrowband UV therapy is reduced, but with cyclosporine we have to be cautious because continuing prolonged can lead to high risk malignancy. With biologics, may potentiate the efficacy, but the comparative data with biologics versus narrowband UV therapy is less. With comparison with other phototherapy, narrowband UV therapy is more effective than broadband therapy. And also, though it is less effective than systemic PUVA therapy, but due to the side effect, narrowband UV therapy is preferred. Coming to atopic, it was mentioned in the Neelmani JC topic, where it was mentioned as a second line therapy. So narrowband UV therapy is effective in moderate to severe atopic dermatitis, and UVA phototherapy is also as effective in moderate to severe atopic dermatitis. So recommendation for this is narrowband UV monotherapy is equally effective in treatment of moderate to severe atopic dermatitis in children. And with topical steroid also, it reduces the severity. And with a patient who is relapsing after the cyclosporine, narrowband UV therapy can be given to maintain remission. Comparing narrowband UV therapy with other phototherapy, narrowband UV therapy is more effective than broadband UV therapy. But it is as effective as bath PUVA and UVA. Coming to CTCL, narrowband UV therapy is can be used in patch test on hypopigmented MF, and it can be also combined with retinoids, and with retinoids that has shown equally effective with good result in combination with retinoids. And comparing sorolin added to narrowband UV therapy and PUVA, there is no benefit of adding sorolin to narrowband UV therapy. It was as efficacious. Comparing narrowband UV therapy with PUVA therapy, as I've already mentioned, that for hyperpigmented lesions or early lesions, narrowband UV therapy is preferred. So this is a comparison between PUVA therapy and narrowband UV therapy. For early PUVA therapy is effective in early stages like 1A, 1B, 2A, And narrowband UV therapy is mainly preferred in 1A stage. Both are maintain equal remission around 55 to 88% in PUVA, and narrowband it was 54 to 91%. The side effects are minimum as compared to the PUVA therapy, but we can encounter erythema, pruritus, burning sensation, blister lesions. Though there is less chances of carcinogen, there is less formation of carcinoma, the theoretical risk for photocarcinogenesis still persists. This is a study comparing the side effect. We can see that the PUVA therapy has a significant side effect as compared to the narrowband UVB therapy. So in PUVA, combination therapy, though it increases the efficacy and also reduces the possible side effect and also cumulative dose of PUVA, similarly in narrowband UVB therapy also. Coming to UVA therapy, the usual wavelength is 340 to 400 nanometer. It is mainly consists, the lamp consists mainly of halide lamps, and the dose of UVA has been divided into three dose regime: low dose, medium dose, and high dose. Low dose is less than 20, medium dose is 20 to 90, and high dose is 90 to 130. The duration varies from what, from 10 minutes to 1 hour. So mechanism action is same as other. It is mainly activation of apoptotic pathway, that is apoptosis of T cell and B cell, immature mast cells, and antigen presenting cells. It also has an immunomodulatory effect, like it decreases the pro-inflammatory cytokines and also decreases the adhesion molecules. Also, main action is mainly it affects on fibroblast. It reduces the production of fibroblast cytokines, and also it increases the collagenase mRNA and also increases matrix metalloprotease expression. So this leads to decreased fibrosis and also softening and disappearance of sclerotic skin. So main indications for UVA therapy is mainly for in morphea, which we encountered, which is atopic dermatitis and scleromyxedema. So this was a study where in systemic sclerosis, where there is acrosclerosis, it was found UVA therapy was found to be have benefit as compared to the other therapies or modality like UVA and PUVA. In other sclerotic disorder, the efficacy of the UVA or PUVA therapy is more evaluation and more studies are required. This is a case where UVA therapy, phototherapy was given where acrosclerosis, and after that we can see here there was significant improvement, and this was also localized scleroderma, and with low dose UVA therapy there was significant improvement. The side effect is mostly acute side effect like hyperpigmentation, redness and dryness and pruritus, which we mostly encountered. Also there is chronic side effects like photoaging that can be seen. Coming to the targeted phototherapy, there are various, this is also known as concentrated phototherapy or focused phototherapy or microphototherapy. There are various sources like broadband, narrowband, or excimer light. Main indications is mostly the localized form or localized vitiligo, which we mostly use as a treatment of therapy. So mostly the advantage is that it spares the uninvolved skin. Also a high dose can be given and also it shortens the duration of treatment and frequent hospital visit. This was a trial conducted in our department where 22 handheld comb machine where it shows that over a 5 minute of time, five minute of time there was a decreased irradiance. This is the hand comb machine and this is the UV meter. This was another study recently published where a handheld comb machine was used where after six months of therapy there was around 50% reduction in the size of the representative patch, and also at around 16 weeks there was 25% of objective global assessment there was reduction. This was another study of handheld narrowband UV therapy where it shows that most of the patient had around 25% improvement in the repigmentation, and here we can see that most of face and neck region they have responded better as compared to the hand and feet, which has shown worsening. So this can be used where in limited or early disease. It can be used mostly in limited and early disease. This was my thesis patient where there has been significant improvement. Coming to the excimer laser, main mechanism is breakage of DNA strand in T lymphocyte, and this is excimer light, which is same mechanism. And the comparison with excimer light with narrowband UV therapy, the excimer light, as I already mentioned, that it has shown more effective as compared to the narrowband UV therapy. And comparing excimer lamp with the excimer laser, both are equally similarly efficacious in treatment of vitiligo. Coming to ECP extracorporeal photochemotherapy, here we take the blood sample and we give UVA therapy, and after that we take the lymphocyte and expose them to the UVA, where we induce where the T cells usually they get apoptosis, and also there is conversion of monocyte to mature dendritic cells, which act against the anti-CD tumor cells. So mainly indicated for CTCL. The side effects can be due to the drug related or due to the venous, or due to cardiovascular lesions can lead to hypotension and tachycardia. These are the absolute indications. So overall summary, to summarize, for psoriasis lesion, when we considered in case of resistance cases to topical therapy, narrowband UV therapy is most effective as compared to the other modality of therapy. For sclerotic conditions, since narrowband therapy usually affects keratinocytes and dendritic cells, it does not go deeper. So broadband UV therapy has found to be more effective, and PUVA therapy is also found to be more effective. Coming to the vitiligo, narrowband UV therapy is the choice. Coming to solar urticaria, where there is UV indication is mainly UV sensitivity, the narrowband UV therapy is the choice. Coming to generalized cutaneous lichen planus, narrowband UV therapy is the choice, and oral lichen planus, where broadband UV therapy is the treatment of choice. Coming to hand eczema, UVA therapy has found to have more effective. In atopic dermatitis, narrowband UV therapy is mostly indicated in chronic disease, where UVA therapy is mostly indicated in acute disease. In CTCL, for early lesions or patch lesions, narrowband UV therapy is mostly preferred. And for plaque-like lesions, PUVA therapy is mostly preferred. For GVHD, the narrowband UV therapy is mostly effective as the initial modality of therapy. For pruritus, mostly narrowband UV therapy can be given. So this is the summarized mechanism. Mostly it decreases Langerhans cells in the epidermis, suppresses contact hypersensitivity, decreases antigen presenting cells, and also effect on mast cell migration and function. So this is helpful in pruritus. DNA damage, down regulation of Th1 helper cells and upregulation of Th2 and T regulatory cells, and also antimicrobial activity. Thank you.
Questions. Please ask questions.
Any questions, please? Yes.
Question by Ananya. Does exam and late work differently from targeted MBUVV? Almost similar wavelength.
Targeted excimer laser basically is 308 nanometer, and the narrow band which we use also ranges from 300 to 313, but mostly specific is 311. So both have similar mechanism of action, but 308 in studies they have found to be more effective as compared to the narrow band handheld therapy. Both have similar mechanisms. 308 nanometer, both have similar mechanisms.
And comment by Dr. Ketha, regular monitoring is the key in light based therapy for best results. Guidelines may not work in all patients. Comments by Dr. Karthi, photodynamic therapy was developed during the same time of phototherapy by Von Tappiner and Jessianek in 1904 using topical eosin and visible light to treat skin tumors, condyloma lata and lupus vulgaris. Photodynamic therapy is a two-step procedure. In the first step, the photosensitizer is administered to the patient by one of the several routes like topical, oral or intravenous, and it is allowed to be taken up to the by targeted cells. The second step involves the activation of photosensitizer in the presence of oxygen with a specific wavelength of light directed towards the tissue. Mechanism of action is by photooxidative reaction, vessel injury, degranulation of neutrophils and release of toxic oxygen radicals. Commonly used photosensitizers are ALA and methyl amino levulinic acid. Topical application of delta ALA and MAL leads to accumulation of endogenous protoporphyrin in significant levels. Indications: actinic keratosis, basal cell carcinoma, Bowen's disease, SCC, melanoma, mycosis fungoides, aging and acne. The side effects of PDT are relatively mild and transient. Burning pain, stinging or itching, erythema and edema restricted to the illuminated area. After PDT, there is crusting and scaling, and then healing takes place for a period of 2 to 8 weeks. Residual hyper or hypopigmentation have also been reported. Question by Dr. Verma, LFT monitoring on poor therapy is required?
In Indian scenario, basically we do baseline. If it is normal, then it is further, it is not required. Thank you.
उसमें ना एक नंबर है हमारे पास, वही नंबर हम पेशेंट को देते हैं, वो पेशेंट अपने आप